second scripture reading we shared this morning is a continuation of what Sue had presented to us earlier, found in John chapter 20, verses 10 through 18. This is when Mary appears at the tomb and finds that Jesus has been risen. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. Easter is probably the best time to be a pastor. I mean, it's when we get to stand up and boldly proclaim what God has done for his people. That the pain and suffering of the previous week that Jesus went through on our behalf comes to nothing. That God has transformed everything, that new life rises from the grave. This is what we as a Christian people are all about. Recognizing that yes, pain and suffering and sorrow are part of our human existence, but that does not define us, who we are as a people. That we are a resurrected people who have the promise and the hope and joy of new life. Not in some intellectual manner, but in real physical form. You know, the primary theme of Easter, of course, is the resurrection. There's no other reason to proclaim Easter. There are different ways to share that story. Sometimes it's a challenge to come to a group of folks with a new way of doing that. But resurrection is a statement that from death comes new life. That from despair, hope can be born. That in the darkness of the tomb, the light of dawn is coming. That death does not have the final say, ever. Many pastors come, and I've done it before, to illustrate the resurrection theme through some of the things we see in the scripture on that day. You know, the stone being rolled away from the grave. They place Jesus' body in the grave, they seal it with cement, huge rock, and then they post guards outside of it. And the morning comes and the stone gets rolled away, and the grave's empty. It's not like they move the stone away and then Jesus comes out. He's already gone. He's overcome the grave. One of my favorites is the one we just shared where Mary's outside the tomb crying after the stone has been rolled away. She's lost hope. Not only have they killed her Lord and Savior, they've taken his body away, and she doesn't know where he is. And she turns around, and he's standing right there, but she doesn't recognize him. She thinks he's the gardener. And then he does that wonderful thing. He speaks her name, Mary. And all of a sudden, her hope and despair spring into new life and joy because she recognizes Jesus. That Jesus, when he speaks your name, can bring new life into your circumstances. And the angels. The angels in the tomb, two of them in the story we just shared, one at the foot and one at the head of where Jesus was. They announced his new life, which ties right back to the Christmas story when the angels come and announce the birth of Jesus. And a violent earthquake. That morning when Mary's there, the earth shakes violently, the guards are scared. We remember that when Jesus died on the cross, the same thing happens. The earth shakes violently. Whenever we see an earthquake in Scripture, it's a sign that God has created a great work. He has done a great feat. And here we know that Jesus has risen from the dead. And it goes on beyond that. Jesus proves that he's really alive. Remember, there's a great concern among the Pharisees and the Romans that perhaps someone has stolen the body and faked this whole thing. That's why the guards are posted there. But Jesus comes and proves that he's really, truly alive. He walks with his disciples on the road to Emmaus. And at first they don't recognize him. And he speaks to them through the scripture. And then he shares a meal with them. And their eyes are open. The presence of Christ creates new life and new understanding right in front of them. Jesus continues on when he goes to the upper room and walks through that wall to be with Thomas, doubting Thomas. And Thomas says, I can't believe that you're real unless I put my hands where your hands are. And he puts his fingers in Jesus' hands and feet. And then Jesus eats a meal with them and proves that he's truly, truly alive. The scripture tells us that when he rose from the grave, he spent some time with his people and was visibly present, physically present, with over 500 of them. So he proves that the resurrection is real. But I want to go a little bit different way this morning. And I have to thank someone for passing this along to me, something I had never known before. It has to do with the linens and the cloth of the tomb. We just finished a Bible study, our Lenten Bible study, a series of six Bible studies. On Sunday and Thursday this week, we talked about something Jesus said when he was on the cross at his point of death. He's on the cross. He's weakened. He knows his end is near. And he says out loud, I am thirsty. So the soldiers that are there, they dip a sponge in a jar of wine vinegar and they raise it up to him to quench his thirst. And as he's on the cross nearing the end, he says these three words, it is finished. He breathes his last and lets go of his spirit. And our Lenten Bible discussion centered around those three words. It is finished. And the question was, what is finished? Is it really, truly finished at the moment he dies on the cross? And as a resurrection people, we know that Jesus' story goes on beyond that point, right? Otherwise, we wouldn't be standing here this day. We also have the promise that he's coming back again. So obviously, it's not finished. So what are we talking about there? We all came to the agreement and understanding that when he says it is finished, he's talking about his part in his earthly ministry. Those 3 years where he walked among the people and did miracles and taught them the way to live and the way to follow God. That part of his journey is finished, but it's not by far done yet. So there's an image in that scripture that has to do with the linen and the cloth in the tomb. And I want to share that with you this morning. the Hebrew tradition of the folded napkin. The Gospel of John, 27, tells us that the napkin, or the cloth that was placed over the face of Jesus, was not just thrown aside like the rest of the grave clothes. The Bible takes an entire verse to tell us that the napkin was neatly folded and placed at the head of that stony coffin. Early Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved. And she said, "They have taken my Lord's body out of the tomb, and I don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple ran to the tomb to see. And the other disciple outran Peter and got there first. He stopped and looked inside the tomb and saw the linen cloth lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter arrives and he goes inside. He also notices the linen wrappings lying there, while the cloth that covered Jesus' face was folded up and lying to the side. Is this important? Absolutely. Is it really significant? Yes, it is. But in order to understand the significance of the folded napkin, you have to understand a little bit about Hebrew tradition of that day. The folded napkin had to do with the relationship between the master and the servant. And every Jewish boy knew the tradition. When the servant set the dinner table for the master, he would make sure that it was exactly the way the master wanted it. The table was furnished perfectly. Then the servant would wait just out of sight until the master had finished eating. The servant would not dare touch that table until the master was finished. Now, if the master was finished eating, he would rise from the table, wipe his fingers, his mouth, clean his beard, and then he would wad up that napkin and toss it under the table. The servant would then know to clear the table, for in those days, the wadded napkin meant, "I am finished." But if the master got up from the table, folded his napkin, and laid it beside his plate, the servant would not dare touch the table because the folded napkin meant, "I am coming back." And so he shouted. See, when the disciples go to the tomb and they see the napkin folded neatly, not tossed up and crumpled into the side, which means you're finished, but noted that it was folded perfectly, they knew that Jesus had made a statement. "I am coming back. It is not finished." See, resurrection is a down payment, the proof, the assurance that God will complete the works he started way back in Genesis. When he brought creation to us and everything was perfect and everything was good. The resurrection says that "I am not yet done my work in the universe." Jesus comes back to life to prove to us that God is making all things new. He is making all things right. His work is continuing to this day. Sin is vanquished. Death does not have the victory. That hope and peace and joy are God's ultimate plan and purpose. That love prevails always. And when he comes again, he will make all things right. He folded that cloth to make a statement that "I am coming back. I am not done. The resurrection story in Easter goes far beyond that Easter morning. It goes far beyond even this morning. It is a powerful reminder and proof that God is returning. Jesus Christ will come from heaven with clouds of glory, and he will make all things right. He is coming back. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you this morning grateful. Grateful for your promise. Grateful for your love that resides in each and every one of us. Grateful that you are still writing the story in our lives. And it is not finished. You have a plan and a purpose for each of us. That we have times of joy and hope and peace in this day that are far beyond what we deserve. But you take it further than that. You promise us, for those who give our hearts to you, that you will make all things right and all things new. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, you have proven this and promised this, and we give you thanks. Amen.